This is Radio Romania International. You are listening to our one-hour broadcast in English for listeners in Western Europe and Japan. We can also be heard on the internet at www.rri.ro, Channel 1. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter and other social media platforms. Our programs are also available on TuneIn and via satellite Eutelsat 16A on 11512 MHz vertical polarization, azimuth 16 degrees east. Symbol rate 29950 mega symbol per second. Standard DBS2 modulation 8PSK audio PID 510. We wish you good reception conditions.
The headlines. Romania's budget bill for 2021 has been launched for public debate on the website of the Finance Ministry. In Romania, the state of alert was extended as of Friday by 30 days due to the coronavirus pandemic. The Romanian Prime Minister Florin Crețu had meetings in Brussels with the President of the European Commission and the President of the European Council. And the Romanian tennis player Simona Halep on Friday qualified to the finals of the Australian Open tournament. Romania's 2021 budget bill has been put up for public debate on the Finance Ministry's website. It is based on a deficit of around 7% of the GDP and an economic growth rate of 4.3%. Remain unchanged. Pensions increase only from January 1st, 2022. Holiday vouchers are no longer granted this year, and students will only benefit from a 50% discount on rail transport. Also, investment is estimated at 5.5% of the GDP, which is more than last year. Leftist opposition as well as employers' associations and the trade union federations criticize austerity measures proposed by the government. The state of alert in Romania has been extended by 30 days due to the coronavirus pandemic. Among the measures in place are compulsory mask wearing, travel restrictions during the night, special conditions for cultural and sports events, and for activities in tourism and the hospitality industry. For both tourism and hospitality industry, there are exceptions and special implementation conditions. The way of calculating the number of infections based on which restrictions are set for regions and localities will be changed. The Romanian Prime Minister Florin Crețu on Friday met with the President of the European Commission, Ursula von der Leyen, so two senior officials addressed issues such as managing the crisis caused by the COVID-19 pandemic, and the goals of combating climate change and the digital transition. The Romanian Prime Minister presented the stage of vaccination campaign in Romania, which places our country on one of the first places in the EU member states. In turn, the President of the European Commission thanked for Romania's decision to donate up to 200,000 vaccine doses to the Republic of Moldova. On the other hand, the Prime Minister Crețu mentioned a priority given by Romania to fulfilling the recommendations of the European Commission and the finalize the cooperation and verification mechanism. He also reiterated Romania's priority objective of joining the Schengen area. We remind you that the cooperation and verification mechanism was established upon Romania's and Bulgaria's accession to the EU on January 1, 2007. As regards Romania's accession to the Schengen area, it was initially scheduled for March 2011, but was repeatedly postponed due to the opposition of some member countries that invoked the lack of reforms in the Romanian judiciary. The two topics were approached on Friday during the meeting of the Romanian Prime Minister Florin Crețu with the President of the European Council, Charles Michel. The European official expressed his support for Romania's efforts in the two cases. Romania continues the anti-COVID-19 vaccination campaign. More than 1 million vaccine doses have been administered so far. Most people have been vaccinated with Pfizer-BioNTech vaccines. Moderna and AstraZeneca vaccines are also being administered to the population. More than 2,550 new cases of the new coronavirus infection were reported nationwide on Friday. Most of them are registered in Bucharest. The total number of cases exceeded 757,000, with a death toll exceeding 19,270. About 1,000 people are in ICUs. On the other hand, Romania has reintroduced quarantine measures for people arriving from several countries, including Hungary. The list includes a total of 66 states which the Romanian authorities consider to have a high risk from the epidemiological point of view, exempted from the two-week quarantine measures. Other people who have recovered from COVID-19 in the last 3 months or have already received both doses of COVID-19 vaccine. The Romanian tennis player Simona Halep was qualified on Friday to the quarterfinals of the Australian Open, the year's previous Grand Slam tournament. Halep defeated the Russian player Veronika Kudermetova, 32nd seeded in the third round, 6-1-6-3. Also on Friday, another Romanian, Sorana Crista, was defeated by the Czech Markéta Vondrousova 6-2-6-4 in the third round of the Australian Open in Melbourne. Crista conceded defeat after 1 hour and 25 minutes to the Czech player, seeded 19th and ranking 20th in the WTA classification. And that was the news from Bucharest, Read Romania International. Since the start of the new year, Romania finally has a draft budget. I'm Helena Ingătescu with more in this report by Bogdan Matei. The draft state budget for the current year is based on a deficit of around 7% and, according to the coalition government, will support the economic recovery and stop excessive and unbounded spending from public money. Liberal Prime Minister Florin Câțu promises a resettling of the economy, fixing what he calls the abnormalities introduced in the legislation in the last 4 years by the former Social Democratic administrations, as well as maintaining the trust of the European Commission, foreign investors and rating agencies. He has also stated that he is waiting for detailed reports on the situation of state-owned companies, including plans to restructure those that have reported losses. In the budgetary system, the head of the government has also said the expenses representing bonuses amount to around 600 million lei, the equivalent of 120 million euros. In pandemic conditions with very high health expenditure, the amputation of these bonuses was worth the hemorrhage of funds, the government says, giving as an example the so-called computer bonus or the COVID bonus, accounting for 30% of the base salary, which is received by prefectural employees. The package of austerity measures also stipulates that children's allowance remain unchanged. Pensions will increase only from January 1st, 2022. This year there will be no more holiday vouchers, and students will no longer benefit from complete free rail transportation. From the opposition, the Social Democratic Party, which has the largest parliamentary group, has already announced that it will table amendments for all important chapters in the draft budget. The Social Democrats lack a vision and solutions for the current issues. It is a budget of austerity, of cuts. It is not people-oriented and does not give good signals for the economy, the leaders of the left say. Beyond the disputes between politicians, austerity measures threaten to escalate tensions in society. Since the beginning of the year, the headquarters of the executive, ministries or parties have been picketed practically every day by dissatisfied trade unionists. Nurses, police staff or prison guards, locomotive drivers or civil servants all demand decent salaries, fair pensions, quality public services. The leaders of one of the biggest union federations in the country, CNS-Alpha, say Romania needs a development budget, not an austerity one. Operators in the HoReCa industry, already affected by the restrictive measures, adopted due to the pandemic, are not at all happy with the announcement that no more holiday vouchers will be issued this year. The Employers' Organization of Hotels and Restaurants in Romania talks about losses of about 7 billion euros in 2020 in an area that employs 400,000 people, which is 7% of Romania's active workforce and produces 5% of the gross domestic product. Pandemic restrictions are to remain in place in Romania for a further 30 days, as the government extends the state of alert. I'm Cristina Mărescu with this report by Eugen Coroianu. Romania will be in a state of alert for another 30 days over the coronavirus pandemic. The extension was proposed by the National Committee for Emergency Situations, chaired by Prime Minister Florin Câțu, and means that a series of restrictions to prevent infections are kept in place. These measures include the wearing of face masks by all persons above the age of 5 in public spaces, at the workplace, in shops and on public transport, the possibility to enforce isolation and quarantine, restrictions on activities involving groups of people with strict rules as to the type and place of gathering allowed, and a curfew on movement at night time between 11 p.m. and 5 a.m. with certain exceptions. Vary depending on the local infection rate. The Prime Minister said, however, that the infection rate will be calculated based on a different formula starting in 2 weeks' time, in keeping with that used in all EU member states. Speaking about the reopening of schools on the 8th of February, President Klaus Iohannis said the situation is good, but emphasized the need for restrictions to be maintained. He said 10,000 schools are open for in-person learning, and that in more than 6,000 others, schools are conducted partly in class and partly remotely. Over 2 million pupils are back in school in Romania, accounting for some 70% of all Romanian pupils. The President and Education Minister Sorin Cîmpeanu on Thursday warned that we must be realistic, the pandemic is not over. Almost 250 pupils and 330 education staff tested positive for COVID only days after the beginning of the new semester. The Education Minister said they all caught the virus during the holiday, and called on parents to keep a close eye on their children's state of health. He advised them to keep them at home if they notice the slightest symptom. President Klaus Iohannis again urged people to get the vaccine when they're offered one, because that's the only way to defeat the pandemic. He said more and more vaccine doses are being delivered to Romania from one month to the next, and that more vaccination centers will be set up. The vaccination program is being rolled out in stages in Romania, and at the moment the demand for vaccination exceeds the supply of available doses. And that was Radio News 3.
Romanian musician with a great passion for jazz, blues and rock music. Here she is now at the microphone with a lot she composed herself, entitled Clothes on Your Heart.
Respirar, sigo el pelo.
International. Focus on Romania. For future stops today.
Hello and welcome. I'm Kevin Kotsu. The World Health Organization that air pollution claims over 7 million lives across the world, also causing illness and missing work days. A recent study indicates that reducing pollution to levels recommended by the International Organization could prevent over 50,000 deaths every year in Europe. The deadly nature of fine particles for health, for instance, is shown mostly in urban areas, where it is manifested in the number of deaths, respiratory and heart disease, disruption of pregnancy, and poor fetal development. Rapid action is needed, aimed at road traffic, industry, ports and airports, but also coal and wood-based heating systems. At present, only 18 European Union countries still use coal, among them Romania, where thermal plants of this type are concentrated in two companies in the south, Zdenia and Funabara. Eliminating coal-fired plants around the world and cutting subsidies for fossil fuels are among the measures that could have a high impact in working towards a clean environment. This considering that Brussels is determined to act more resolutely for fighting climate change. In December, member states announced that by 2030 they would reduce by at least 55% their emission of greenhouse gases as compared to 1990. On longer term, the aim would be to reach climate neutrality by 2050. According to Bloomberg, in 2020, renewable energy sources produced 38% of the electricity needed by the European Union as compared to 34% in 2019. This increase was enough to offset for the first time the amount of energy produced by fossil fuels. The rapid rise in wind and solar forced coal on a descending slope. 2020, however, was also the year in which restrictions imposed by the pandemic affected the demand for energy on the continent, as recalled on Radio Romania by Otilianotu, public policy analyst for energy and infrastructure with the Expert Forum. With the present policies, last year, for the first time, energy from renewable sources exceeded that produced by fossil fuel. The expectation is that in 2021, we would get back to the coal sector, but most likely the longer-term shock will be an acceleration in reducing basic coal capacity. The question is what to replace it with. We will definitely have to replace it with new and flexible plants to also cope with the discontinuities in renewable sources. However, the idea is to build capacities that don't get us stuck in consumption of fossil sources over a long period of time. Otilianotu explained that replacing coal with gas-fired plants could create another kind of problem. Even if they pollute less than coal, the problem is that an investment in a gas plant gets a return in about 30 years. The statistics in the European Union show that in 2019, production of energy based on coal, gas, and oil was 71% less, a significant drop over the last few decades, thanks to the rise in renewable energy. In the case of Romania, the figure is 73%. The president of the Intelligent Energy Association, Dumitru Kiselica, recalls that over the last 5 years, there have been numerous accords signed by Romania. These agreements are aimed at reducing carbon emissions, and the main targets were coal-fired plants. He said we have to prepare for the future.
We have to expect that in 2025, we will have a decision related to individual coal-fired centrals,
and in 2030, another one that will have to do with means of transportation. All these elements are already being anticipated. The investments that will have to be made are both in terms of green production, but also storage. Because we have to bear in mind that green energy is not continuous.
It is dependent on the weather. And then we, the EU and Romania both, have to develop major storage capacities that can quickly come online and supplement energy when it goes down. Also, network technology will have to be taken into consideration because it will have to be adapted to how renewable systems operate, which will be another major investment component. Last but not least, we have to see a wish to consume renewable, a demand. We are talking about a massive conversion of transportation from classic fuels to electric supplies. And also, by 2050, we should have moved away from heating with and gas, going for electric. All this means huge capacities, which have to be developed to supplement this consumption, which will incur very high costs. You have been listening to The Future Starts Today.
International Broadcasting from Bucharest. Expat in Romania.
Welcome everyone, I'm Vlad Falco. Guillaume Popov is a young man of French and Russian origin. He was born in France and is currently working in the IT sector. After spending a few years in Brazil, in France and other countries, Guillaume eventually got to Romania, where he has been living for the past 7 years. To me, Romania was a sort of revelation from the very beginning. In my studies, I used to get bored really fast, and I thought that if I'm not comfortable sitting at my desk and attending lectures every day, then I should do some traveling. So I went to England and other countries before getting to Romania. Romania was not the first country I visited, and it was certainly not on my list, but it's definitely the country where I've stayed the most. I got to Romania after meeting my future wife in England, and she's Romanian. I was anxious to know more about her culture, and together we decided to move here. Why not? Let's give it a try. I'm sure anything's possible anywhere, and I don't care what they say about Romania, what I've heard before coming here. If you don't see it for yourself, you'll never truly know. Guillaume Popov. Guillaume speaks Romanian quite well, but he didn't need to learn the language. We asked him if it was hard adapting to life in Romania. It was indeed a big step. I adapted really quickly, I think. It was a bit difficult at first, but not in a bad sense. The people here are open-minded, well-mannered, and they speak so many languages. When I got here, no one wanted to talk to me in Romanian. I couldn't learn the language at all during my first year, because everyone was talking in English or French. For this reason, adapting was a bit difficult, but in a good sense, I was very well received. I was the one who wanted to learn the language, and I'm still learning. Learning Romanian has helped Guillaume understand more and get familiar with various aspects of everyday reality. I visited other post-Soviet countries, and to me, Romania seems to be very different. I'd say the interwar period still has strong echoes today, a time when Romania was part of a greater world. You can see that in Romanian culture and traditions. You can still feel Romania and France are interconnected. Romania is different from what I've seen in Macedonia, Bulgaria or Ukraine. The mentality here is like a mix between the West and the East. Now the people are friendlier than elsewhere in Eastern Europe. And Romania is not Ion's final destination, as our guest has told us.
Probably un pic de vin.
When I'm living in Romania, I'm definitely taking some wine with me. The wine thing I enjoy the most during my time here has been people's warmth. The people here have a very particular way of making others feel at home. So, apart from wine, I would take with me a memory of the people I've met and their stories. Guillaume Popov, today's expat in Romania.
Serena Cristensimona has third round of the Australian Open, which is the year's first Grand Slam tournament. Cristensimona outclassed the tournament's newest player, the Czech Republic's Petra Kvitová, 6-4, 1-6, 6-9. Second-seeded competitor Simona Halep secured a win against Australian challenger Ayla Tomljanovic, also in three sets, 4-6, 6-4, 7-5. Simona's win was a hard-fought one, which came from behind, overturning Tomljanovic's 5-2 advantage during the match. In news from women's handball, on Wednesday, Manaura Bayamare made a huge leap towards the quarterfinals of the European League. Minaura thrashed Norwegian opponents Storhamar at home, 40-27. Minaura Bayamare are at the top of the table in Group C, with 6 points in 4 games played. Minaura's last quarterfinal will see the remaining 2 non-German opponents, Thuringer on February the 20th and the 21st, and Heimcourt. The first 2 teams of the group will go through to the quarterfinals. Romania's capital city, Bucharest, this month is back on the European map of football competitions. First leg of the Champions League's round of 16, beating Atletico from Madrid against Chelsea FC on Tuesday, February the 23rd, will be hosted by the national from Bucharest, starting 2200 hours. UEFA's decision has been taken in the wake of the restrictions imposed to the English delegation related to travelling on Spanish territory. The match will be played behind closed doors. In domestic football, standing towards Romanian Cup's round of 16 are underway this week. On Tuesday, second league team Petrol Ploiești secured a 3-0 win against Brăila. Cluj-Napoca Târgoviște grabbed a 3-0 win against second league team Vărul Constanța on Wednesday. Another second league team, Universitatea Cluj, defeated UTA Arad on home turf 3-0, while Dinamo Bucharest won the home game they played against FCSV 1-0. On Thursday, second league squad Pandurii-Târgu-Jiu are pitted against Gazmetan Mediaș, Poli Timișoara play Astra Giurgiu, and FC Botoșani play Universitatea Craiova. Another second league team, Dunărea Călăraș, has got through to the Cup's quarter-finals, since Turis Oltul-Cluj-Măgurele has pulled out from competition. And that's all from Sports Flash this week. You can also access our sports items at rr.co and Facebook. Coming up next in the program here is truly Romanian. I'm Eugen Nasta. Today we bring you songs from the Upper Mureș River Valley at the foothill of Giurgiu Mountains in Harghita County. To start off, here is an old song from the region, performed by Ioan Cristian Caran.
Câte două sing a birthday. It's a birthday party.
Next up in the program,
here's an honor song from his repertoire.
Johan Christian Zeran's rich repertoire of traditional dance songs from his native region have been included on a CD, where the arrangement and the accompaniment for the 15 cuts have been provided by Kuhata Ovidiu Bartes. Coming up next in the program, here's another beautiful song performed by Johan Christian Zeran.
Find a good time, it's a move. Also producer of traditional music shows with the Romanian television's regional radio in Târgu Mureș, central Transylvania. You're now invited to listen to a fine song performed by Ioan Cristian Țăran, a song praising the beauty of his native region.
Today with another beautiful song from Ioan Cristian Țăran's repertoire.
Coming up next, through the loop. Looking Glass.
Hello and welcome to a new edition of To the Looking Glass with me, Elena. Today we take a look at the most recent decisions taken at the level of the European Union, decisions that also concern Romania. There are two main topics that we will cover in the next few minutes, namely the prospects of economic recovery at the level of the EU and the political agreement on the Recovery and Resilience Facility. So stay tuned. Europe remains in the grip of the coronavirus pandemic. The resurgence in the number of cases, together with the appearance of new, more contagious strains of the coronavirus, have forced many EU member states to reintroduce or tighten containment measures. At the same time, the start of the vaccination programs throughout the EU provides ground for cautious optimism. In this context, the winter 2021 economic forecast recommended by the European Commission projects that the euro area economy will grow by 8% in both 2021 and 2022. The forecast projects that the EU economy will grow by 3.7% in 2021 and by 3.9% in 2022. According to a release posted on the European Commission's website, the euro area and EU economies are expected to reach their pre-crisis levels of output earlier than anticipated in the autumn 2020 economic forecast, largely because of the stronger-than-expected growth momentum projected in the second half of 2021 and 2022. After strong growth in the third quarter of 2020, economic activity contracted again in the fourth quarter as a second wave of the pandemic triggered renewed containment measures. With those measures still in place, the EU and euro area economies are expected to contract in the first quarter of 2021. Economic growth is set to resume in the spring and gather momentum in the summer as vaccination programs progress and containment measures gradually ease. An improved outlook for the global economy is also set to support the recovery. The economic impact of the pandemic remains uneven across member states, and the speed of the recovery is also expected to vary significantly. Thus, a group of EU member states will be able to fully recover this year, including Latvia, Lithuania, Luxembourg and Poland. Finland and Sweden will come close to a complete return of their economic powers. The 2021 growth in countries like Germany, France, Belgium, Portugal, Denmark, Malta, Bulgaria, Hungary and Romania will not be enough to recoup all the losses, and they will have to wait until next year to see a complete improvement, according to current thinking. Meanwhile, southern countries such as Spain, Greece and Italy might have to wait even longer after plunging 11%, 10% and 8.8% in 2020, respectively. Their estimated numbers in 2021 and 2022 will fail to totally compensate the shock. The forecast projects that inflation in the euro area is set to increase from 0.3% in 2020 to 1.4% in 2021, before moderating slightly to 1.3% in 2022. Paolo Gentiloni, Commissioner for Economies at the Munich Conference following the release of the winter 2021 economic forecast.
The economic situation this winter remains silent. Since the autumn, many member states have reintroduced tightened containment measures in response to the resurgence in infections and more recently to the spread of new variants of the virus. To be clear, these measures are necessary. And of course, they affect economic activity, although to a much lesser degree than in spring last year. Second, because the recession in 2020 was not as deep as expected, and thanks to the breakthroughs we had in vaccines, we now project the EU economy will return to its pre-crisis GDP level in 2022. This, for assumes that the current companion measures will ease towards the end of the second quarter this year, and then more markedly in the second half of the year, when the most vulnerable and an increasing share of the adult population should have been vaccinated. Containment measures are then assumed to be marginal towards the end of this year, with only targeted sectoral measures still present in 22. Overall, EU GDP is now forecast to grow about 3.7% this year and 3.9% in 22, after a contraction estimated at 6.3% last year.
That was Paolo Gentiloni, EU Commissioner for Economy. Risks surrounding the forecast are more balanced since the autumn, though they remain high. They are mainly related to the evolution of the pandemic and the success of vaccination campaigns. Positive risks are linked to the possibility that the vaccination process leads to a faster than expected easing of containment measures and therefore an earlier and stronger recovery. Also, Next Generation EU, the EU's recovery instrument, of which the centerpiece is the recovery facility, could fuel stronger growth than projected, since the envisaged funding has, for the most part, not yet been incorporated into this forecast. In terms of negative risks, the pandemic could prove more persistent or severe in the near term than assumed in this forecast, and there could be delays in the rollout of vaccination programs. This could delay the easing of containment measures, which would in turn affect the timing and strength of the expected recovery. There is also a risk that the crisis could leave deeper scars in the EU's economic and social fabric, notably through widespread bankruptcies and job losses. This would also hurt the financial sector, increase long-term unemployment, and worsen inequalities. On the 10th of February, European Parliament's vote confirmed the political agreement with the Recovery and Resilience Facility Regulation in December 2020. This marked an important step towards making €672.5 billion in loans and grants available to member states to support reforms and investments. The Recovery and Resilience Facility is the key instrument at the heart of the EU's plan for emerging stronger from the COVID-19 pandemic, a plan called Next Generation EU. It will play a crucial role in helping Europe recover from the economic and social impact of the pandemic and will help make the EU's economies and societies more resilient and secure the green and digital transitions. The approval of the European Parliament paves the way for the Recovery and Resilience Facility to come into force in the second half of February. Member states will then be able to officially submit their national recovery and resilience plans, which will be assessed by the European Commission and adopted by the Council. The recovery and resilience plans set out the reforms and public investment projects that will be supported by the Recovery and Resilience Facility. The Commission is already engaged in intensive dialogue with all member states on the preparation of these plans. Refinancing of 13% of the total amount allocated to member states will be made available once recovery and resilience plans are approved to ensure that financing arrives where it's needed as quickly as possible. The Recovery and Resilience Facility is structured around six pillars: green transition, digital transformation, economic cohesion, productivity and competitiveness, social and territorial cohesion, health, economic, social and institutional resilience, and policies for the next generation. It will help the EU achieve its target of climate neutrality by 2050 and set it on a path of digital transition, creating jobs and spurring growth in the process. And that has been Through the Looking Glass.
Coming up next on Radio Romania International. Simply Folk. Welcome everyone, I'm Vlad Palku. Today we will be introducing you to Tita Ștefan, a folk vocalist born in southern Romania. During his career, he got to work together with prestigious orchestras, the most notable of which is the Ion Albeșteanu Ensemble. Let's listen to him performing a song about his native county.
Europe and Japan has come to an end. You can listen to our next program for Western Europe tomorrow at 6:30 hours UTC on 7345 kHz in analog system and on 6040 kHz in the DRM system. Listeners in Japan can listen to our next program tomorrow at 23 hours UTC on 7325 kHz and 9620 kHz. They can also be heard on the internet at www.rri.ro, channel 1. If you have any comments or suggestions, please write an email at entl@rri.ro. Goodbye.